Good evening. Welcome to another edition of the DMV Daily Radio Show. I'm your host, Hassan Giordano, a.k.a. Mr. Politics, and we are back only days after the holiday season and only a few days before the new year. Happy holidays to all of you who celebrate, and boy, do we have a belated Christmas gift for you today. Joining us in studio is someone who won, not one, but two elections, and I ain't talking about the primary and the general either. This year alone, both as a state senator and another as the first vice chairman of the Maryland Democratic Party, making him DMV Daily's Baltimore Man of the Year in our new year edition that's set to be released in a few days. You didn't make man of the state. That's what's going to have to go to our governor, who's the first Republican to win re-election since the 1950s, overcoming cancer. It's kind of hard to beat that.
I'm glad to play runner-up.
But before we get into that and our guests and to the show, as always, I like to let you know that this program is brought to you by our fine sponsors, such as that stellar legal group known as the Bates & Garcia Law Firm. Specializing in criminal defense, real estate, and bodily injury cases, Bates & Garcia is Maryland's legal dream team. And while I'm sure you know the number by heart by now, especially now that we have their customized commercials running day and night around the clock on our 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week news feed, just in case you forgot it, pull out your smartphone, store it in your contacts like I got it under attorney. So as soon as the police even think about pulling me over, I dial 410-814-4600, and so should you. The show is also brought to you by those savvy political strategists at Politicom Strategic Solutions, who have mastered the art of political communications and have successfully gotten people elected to office since the 1970s with a man by the name of Art Murphy. If you are thinking about running for office in 2020, make sure you give them a call today to get your campaign set up with a user-friendly website, integrated social media sites, and a campaign plan to ensure success. They can be reached at 240-242-7505 and on the web, www.politicomsolutions.com. And of course, where would we be without the fine support of the best union in America, as my screen just went down, SEIU 500, who wants you to know that Together We Rise is not just a slogan, but rather a blueprint for the future of the union movement. Contact them today and support their efforts at www.seiu500.org. And if you are a business owner or have a product that you want branded on our website and on our multiple podcast programs like Bates & Garcia, Politicom, and SEIU 500, give us a buzz today to get your cost-effective advertising package set up for the new year. 443-294-3900 is the number. Info at DMV Daily News. Remember, now we have a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week stream broadcast network, both radio and video on DMV Daily News. You can always watch us online. If you missed the previous day's program, if you simply want to listen to this program over again later on in the evening, you can hear us 24/7 on the website, www.dmvdaily.news. And with the new year set to begin next week, DMV Daily Media is set to launch an all-new podcast system, live stream radio stations, and shows just like this one, along with a weekly Annapolis report as the session is about to get going in January, a legal podcast, a fantasy sports podcast, and much more. So if you want your podcast produced and heard daily or weekly on DMV Daily, as well as on sites such as iTunes, TuneIn, Stitcher, Spotify, Alexa, and Google Play, or seen on sites such as Facebook, Periscope, and YouTube Live, along with DMVDaily.news, then now's the time to contact us. Call us, 443-294-3900 is the number. Email us, info at DMVDaily.news, or go to the website. You can sign up for it right there. We'll get you down here to our new studios, 2421 Maryland Avenue in Charles Village, and make your podcast an internet sensation overnight. Joining me in studio, as usual, are my two co-hosts. To my left is our trusted legal advisor, none other than half of that stellar legal team known as Bates & Garcia. My main man, Ivan Bates Esquire, is in the house. What's happening,
Kevin? Hey, what's up? What's up, B Moore?
And to my right is none other than your union boss of all bosses. I didn't taught y'all the Italian name for it. Capo de tutti capi. Mr. Mark McLaren is in the building.
Happy Thursday, family.
And of course, as always, producing the program and the studio engineer for the DMV Daily Media Studios, my right-hand man, Jason Rodriguez, is in the house.
What's up, family?
He's a little slow today. And shout out to our podcast producer and website creator, Andy Pierre. Now, if you want to join in on today's conversation, you can always call in or even text your questions or comments in to the studio phone lines. That number, 410-819-2370. And if you're watching on Facebook Live, like Kalen Young and LaWanda Perkins and Liz Nudo and Joseph Kane and Jack McCray and Shane Bryan and so many others, then make sure that you put your comment or question on here, on the feed, and we'll make sure to get you into the conversation today. Jack McCray says, congratulations to the man of the year, Cory McCray.
Appreciate that, Jack.
People think I'm joking. I've done, and every year I do it for DMV Daily. We do the 2018 wrap-up, and we have the Maryland man of the year, the Baltimore man of the year, and female of the year, and same thing with Maryland. And we do a lot of political, union, business, all different field. So, yeah, Mr. McCray has definitely finished first in that program today. Of course, I kind of gave away the secret, but if you didn't know who I was talking about earlier in the program, then you must have been living under a rock this past year or these past few years, because I can remember. It's funny thing is, I still remember this guy walking in the city hall years ago saying, you know what? I'm trying to get involved in this political thing. And it was like, all right, well, just keep coming back. And I'd be damned if you didn't come back every damn city council meeting. And then, you know, it's remarkable. 4 years ago, he ran for a state delegate, won that. 4 years later, ran for state senator against an entrenched incumbent, won that. And then a few months after that, after the primary, ran for first vice chair of the Maryland Democratic Party and won that. Have you ever lost a campaign?
Yeah, we've lost a campaign before.
Oh, really?
We have.
Central Committee. 44 years ago.
Just taught me a lot. Taught me a lot.
But you know what? That's a good kind of segue in, because a lot of people, when I want you to talk to people, especially those who are listening, who I know are political, who want to run for office, who may have ran and lost before, talk to them about, that first campaign and that not being a deterrent or a distraction from you. Because a lot of people feel discouraged. They get in, they run, whether it's with Central Committee or whatever, and they lose, and it's like, whatever, it's rigged, and I don't want to be a part of it. But even Barack Obama lost his first real race.
Yep. First, I just want to say I'm honored to be able to sit in this room with these four distinguished gentlemen that are doing so much great work for the city of Baltimore. So the reality is a lot of people talk via Facebook about the work that they're doing. Like, we see them in the streets and continuously doing it, consistently doing it. So thank you for the work that you do in lifting the city of Baltimore. And just in reference to the campaign for Central Committee and the campaigns that we've been through, the campaigns that we just went through. I know, Hassan, in reference to the state central committee, like, the one thing that I was frustrated with was that folks didn't tell me how things really worked. So I knew I had a work ethic. I knew I was loyal to the city of Baltimore. But when I was knocking on all doors, nobody said, hey, here's a list. And like, here's how you do it more efficiently with the 3 months that you have to go in. I remember when I was asked to run for Central Committee, I only had 3 months. I didn't realize that people were preparing for these seats 2 years, 4 years, sometimes long-term ventures to prepare for it, when I was asked in 3 months and genuinely just wanted to give my all in that 3 months. So I ran a hard campaign. I remember the signs on the truck. I remember working the early voting polls. So I did the things that I knew or only knew, but the reality is that I knew something was missing. Something was missing in reference to a body of people before us establishing or letting us know how things worked or how practices thing and how do you get it done. And the reality is that if you can't always have that mentor in front of you, I always say read about it. I always say go out there. So we had different trainings. I learned from my labor union. I learned from so many different things from that campaign. But one of the things, the greatest pieces that I learned, Hassan, that I learned, and was in reference to making sure that once you get there, you reach back and you show other people how to do it. So when I think about the Chris Burnetts, when I think about the John Bullocks, the Shannon Sneeds, those folks that have put themselves forward, that have the right, that are very intelligent people, that have their hearts in the right place, don't leave them behind, because the reality is that we all don't know exactly everything to do, and we can learn from each other, but you have to reach a hand out, extend that hand out, and help other people get there.
And speaking of that, I remember the Best Democratic Club and the founding of the Best Democratic Club. Even as an independent, we was part of the Best Democratic Club. People would ask me, how the hell are you a part of a Democratic Club? You an independent fool. But the principles of the Best Democratic Club are still here and still around. You mentioned some of them, the Shannon Snees, the John Bullocks, the others who've come out of the Best Democratic Club. What's next for the Best Democratic Club moving forward? You guys had a lot of success with yourself and John and Shannon and so many others. 2020 is right around the corner. What do you see? You know, there's rumors that a certain young lady that I'm very fond of that may be related to you, Danny McCray, may be running. I mean, tell us, you know, overall. We're going to open this up.
I think that's
the Best Democratic Club.
Yeah, I think that with Hassan, as I say, hey, and I'm sitting across from him, like, we've been through so much, but I think this guy's always been there for my first. So, like, the first week that we went out knocking doors, Mark, for the House of Delegates, you will see that picture, and you'll see it's, like, eight people that's with us, but you look at it and see who's there. There go Hassan Giordano.
I got it up on my computer somewhere.
So, yeah, I'm about to say, so then when he talked about the best, I remember, like, the Overly. I remember, like, the Chef Max, and I remember who's always on the scene, never missing a beat, has always been Hassan Giordano. So just as you take me down memory lane, as I'm sitting right here in front of you, I think about those moments, and it's very, very appreciative. And very, very, you hit me, man. You hit me pretty, hit it pretty hard. But in reference to what's next, I think that what's next for myself is in reference to going to this legislature. We just came off of a Senate campaign. The reality is that it's easy to win elections. The hard part is actually going in there and getting something done. So one of the things that I really got a singular focus on is going into the General Assembly, working on pieces of legislation. Six of them I've already pre-filed that you can find on the Maryland General Assembly's website, but also making sure that we can take on some big tackle some big issues, but also sitting on the Budget and Taxation Committee is not a small feature. And in reference to making sure that being one of only two people from the city, being one of only two African Americans on there, when we look at the Capitol Subcommittee and being the only African American on that subcommittee, we have a large responsibility in making sure that we deep dive into these subject matters to make sure that Baltimore is represented when you're talking about the money for the state of Maryland. Mm-hmm. And then in reference to 2020, you know, I sit down with a lot of people that are actually thinking about running or seeking a run, Hassan, and just try to give them every piece of guidance that I can give them. Because I always tell folks, even if you had, first, nobody's going to outwork me is how I always feel. So nobody can physically, mentally outwork me. Folks will know, like, Cory will sit there and be up in the middle of the night. Cory will be up early in the morning trying to get the goal covered. And at the same time, the reality is that even sometimes when you hand a person all the tools in the toolbox, Ivan, nobody can go in that courtroom like you can go in that courtroom. So, like, that's how I feel in reference to campaigns. So when I talk to folks, whether they're friend or foe, I still hand them everything that I know, whether it's how do you tackle the early voting piece? How do you tackle the election day piece? How do you tackle the absentee piece? Which a lot of people tend to lose that piece of it. But how do you also target folks? How do you intentionally, continuously keep hitting them? How I knock on a door, then I write a letter, then I make a phone call, all of that within a 7 to 10 day period to kind of saturate that person and know that when I left them from that contact and those multiple contacts, they know who I am. So those are the things that I always try to hand the jewels over to somebody else, because the reality is that they make me sharper and they make me come out and do it a little bit better. I always say steel sharpens steel. So, like, we have to continuously not hold on to the stuff we know, give it all to them, and challenge me to be a better person.
Well, I like how you avoided the Danny McCray second edition, especially with Brandon Scott on here, whose seat is supposed to be going to her if he runs citywide. I'm just saying.
I live in the second Charismatic district, and the reality is that I still have a councilman that's doing a pretty fine job that's throughout the second Charismatic district. So it's very early to know what my councilman is doing, but you have to have a finger on the pulse.
I just want to get into what you talked about. Budget and taxation is huge.
Yes, sir.
I've always had a big problem with, so we had this back in the day, and I know some people are on the other side of the fence on this. You know, we get into, we want to throw mama from the train, so to speak, sometimes. Mm-hmm. We did this years and years and years ago when the delegate, Pete Rollins, chair of the House Appropriations, in the Senate, it was Barbara Hoffman. Mm-hmm. He decided to get rid of Barbara Hoffman by putting Lisa Gladden there. Mm-hmm. We took away leadership from that chairmanship. She was at the back of the seat, at the back of the bus, so to speak. Then he passes away 2 years later, and we lost that chairmanship. Budget and tax, that's huge. I think the young people that we got coming in are going to make that difference. Mm-hmm. But what we did lose on environmental EA. They change it up now. Education, health, and environmental affairs now. Mm-hmm. Regardless of the chairmanship, we lost that and Barbara Robinson. We have not one person from Baltimore City has been put on that committee from Mike Miller, the Senate president, which is going to be in charge of education.
Shirley.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Shirley is not Baltimore City. I mean, she has a sliver of it, but let's be honest, 44 is going to be gone for Baltimore City at the next re-election.
Well, but she actually lives in the 41st, so she
She represents the 44th, right? Which is only one-third of Baltimore City, and we know with redistricting coming up, it's going to be gone, right? There's no real Baltimore City representation on that committee, and redistricting goes before that committee.
That's right.
Along with voting rights, and you know how big voting rights is. You were part of this whole former felons bill expansion, and health,
Kerwin,
and Kerwin education. So how do we force Mike Miller to be able to say, you know what, we need a true representative from Baltimore City on this committee?
I would just go back and say that she do still represent the city of Baltimore for this four years that we're
in. So like you said,
a third of the district. So you got a delegate and you got a senator. So Keith Haynes wouldn't say that he a pinky.
Not in the Senate. He's on the House side.
Yeah, but
we need somebody in that committee in the Senate.
Yep. But one of the things when we did redistricting was protecting the city by ensuring that we didn't just lose the whole district. We ended up having a delegate and a senator where we only lost those two delegates. Mm-hmm.
But can we get a senator on this goddamn committee that's from Baltimore City?
If only we had a terminally degreed educator and demographer that would have been elected to the city delegation that could have gone to EHE. We don't have anyone like... No, wait. Yes, we do. We have Mary Washington. But
was purposely not put on this committee.
Because out of spite to Joan. Right.
Absolutely.
Joan Spike.
Which is ridiculous because she was put on a committee that we already had a Baltimore City representative.
Absolutely. So and she's one of only two non-attorneys on JPR. Judicial proceedings is where attorneys go. She got put on JPR because Joan didn't want her sitting in her seat. That's all it was.
But she wouldn't have been a chair, though.
I know.
That's ridiculous. And that's what I'm talking. That's what I was getting to. But can we have a push?
And keep in mind, 2 years ago, we didn't have any city senators on JPR.
That's right.
Not one.
Yeah, we had Lisa Gladden.
She was sick.
Lisa's
so it was
gone.
A time that she was sick, and Nat went over to finance.
Right. And Dolores took her place, and Dolores was
with the county.
So we
had zero on JPR two years ago.
Yep.
Yeah, well, the hell with JPR right now. That was only for 2 years. I'm talking about, to me, EHE is the most important, besides budget. Budget is huge.
Budget is pretty important.
Yeah.
Budget is, but with redistricting coming up especially, voting rights and Kerwin, this is the most important committee, period. And Mike Miller knows that. And he chose to play politics with it instead of saying, you know what, let me equally. Because if you take Mary Washington and put her there, we got Jill on JPR. Yes. We got you on budget and tax, along with isn't Ferguson on it too?
He is. Yes. He's the vice chair.
We got everyone covered.
And Antonio's covering finance. That's right.
We got everyone covered. But instead, playing petty politics, we got two on a committee that we really should have one. That's just my gripe. You don't got to answer that. I just want to make that known.
I'm taking it all in. Some folks would say Shirley is a senator. Yeah. I know she's in the meetings with us when we have city senator meetings.
What, the Senate delegation meeting?
Yeah, when we
I don't know why. She don't show up for Baltimore shit. I'll be honest with you.
Is this like one of those shows that's like covered?
It's covered. Yeah, we're online. So, it's FCC regulated. You can cuss a little bit. It's still a family show, so we try not to go that far out there. But, look, let's be honest. Shirley's a great young... I like Shirley, personally. I think we could have did better this election. The young lady that was running against her in the primary, I think, would have been a great replacement. But nonetheless, I think Shirley, especially with health.
Yeah.
Right? I agree with that.
She's a registered nurse.
But again, you represent an entire district of Baltimore City, one of the larger districts in Baltimore City.
And keep in mind, the Kerwin Commission stuff is going to be jointly assigned. So the budget and EE will both be working on that subject matter.
I know you don't want to upset the apple cart, and Mike Miller, you just coming in. I get that. I know he watches this.
He was just appointed assistant to the chief deputy majority whip. He got out with this.
Does that even mean? The assistant to the chief deputy of the majority whip.
I made that up. Don't listen to me.
Okay. I'm about to say. Because I'm going to tell you something. A lot of them down there, you've seen this.
Mm-hmm.
They come, and this is certainly hasn't been you or Antonio that I've seen in the 4 years that y'all been there. But a lot of them do, and Mary neither. go down there and they represent the people. But then when they give them a little position of, oh, you the chief whip of the whip of the whip. Mm. Oh, boy, I can't vote on
that. I'm in leadership. I got to support leadership.
How dare you speak out against.
I'm the deputy sergeant at arms. I got to support the team.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can't.
Was I supposed to sit over here?
No, they got you sitting close right. The door, goddamn. You can't go now. You
sitting right there. Senator Elect. I'm just sitting here taking it
off.
No,
man, I'm having a ball, man.
So, let's just say Hassan has some strong views. Let's change the subject.
Yep.
Let's talk about your other job that you won, the vice chair.
Yep.
What are some of your plans for that?
The reality is that I want to make sure that we highlight other folks. When we think about the party, we think about the Senate president. We think about the speaker. We think about our federal partners. But it's so much larger than that. So you have a Vanessa Atterbury and a Terry Hill over in Howard County that's doing great, phenomenal things. You have Pat Young and Sidnor out in Baltimore County. You have Mark Corman and Janelle Wilkins out in Montgomery County. So you have all these things. And the reality is how you lift the Democratic Party up is showing things that they actually connect with. These are people that they actually like. These are people that actually got put in office because people like them. And when you see that face, the Democratic Party is so much bigger than six or seven people. It's a large party, and we have to push that when we're talking about our communications and our messaging in reference to when we highlight the party. The first thing that I would also think about is just supporting our chair. I think that I've been in a lot of different organizations, but the main part of making sure that the organization thrive is also when we support those that are in leadership or that leadership position. Why is that important? Because when she wins, I win. When you win, I win. So what? Let's win together piece is what I'm basically trying to say. Supporting the chair, uplifting those young folks, middle-aged folks, those folks. And then the other piece is to make sure that the training part. So I've been given a lot of talents in reference to campaigns. And one of the things is that we can highlight those talents on a statewide basis when we're talking about looking at mail and what does mail supposed to look like? How do you communicate? How do you knock on doors? How do you intentionally target new people that are registered? How do you target the folks that might have filled out an absentee ballot? What are the intentional things that we do? A lot of folks may not know those pieces of the puzzles, but I'm always willing to share it and just put something together for us. So I look forward to working with not only the chair, but we have some phenomenal people as Nicole Williams, Allison, Robbie Leonard, folks that all were there, Bob Kresslin, that were there and just trying to help uplift the organization in reference to the party.
Speaking of the Central Committee,
I would like to file an official protest
on Larry Hogan being named the Man of the Year, because Larry Hogan got reelected to his office. I believe this is the only man in Maryland that unseated two incumbents in 1 year, okay? Sherrod Barnes and Mac McFadden were both two long-term incumbents that he unseated. So I would argue that is a more spectacular feat.
Right? And then was the first Republican in over 60 years to win re-election.
Right, he held on to something he already had.
I just want to file
a protest. That's all. Could be overruled. I'm just filing a protest.
That was the man of Maryland. He did what he did, Baltimore City and Maryland, to be quite honest. And he's just as important. Just like the woman of Baltimore is Maya Rocky Moore Cummins, who but she started off the year as a gubernatorial candidate, right? Unselfishly resigned that position to take care of her husband, who was ailing at the time, only to months later rebrand herself and knock off the chair of the Democratic Party.
I agree. She's definitely the
who got the endorsement from the floor of the strongest United States senator in Maryland, and she still wiped the board with.
Isn't she the woman of the year for the entire state then?
Yes, absolutely.
She could be considered that, yeah.
Well, who's going to then be?
Because then I will put in Mary Washington as the woman of the year for Baltimore City, who has done her due diligence in, I mean, let me tell you, people expected you to win.
They did.
Because there was a whole lot of people telling me I couldn't win.
Whipping that ass. Antonio, they kind of expected him to win. Nobody in their mama, except a small few of us that was in Mary's camp, expected Mary Washington to win. Mm. They were like, it's possible, but I'm going to put my money on Antonio and Corey. I ain't going to put my money on Mary Washington. It was a very small few of us, and she did it. And she did it masterfully, to be quite honest. Y'all all did. So I think she deserves because, again, I ain't gonna get into the personal stuff with that. Disclaimer
here: that's views and opinions
are of DMV Daily and everybody on this damn panel. Mike Miller, I know you're watching.
Oh, sweet Jesus!
Those Hassan Jet. Views and
opinion exclusive.
But I would ask the question like, man, you gonna be working hard? That's what we're gonna be doing. Man.
I mean, yeah, but you're a hard worker. Basically, what I'm trying to say is, you're gonna be looking at your wife saying, "Baby, I need continue to hold me down like you have," because your wife has really been a backbone for you.
I've known Demetrius since I was 17 years of age, and one of the things that I find very, very important is that what we do with the time that we're given. And I think that because of experience that I may have had in life, I really, really value time. But I always still try my best to cut out time for my young kids. So on Saturdays at 4 o'clock, we know I'm gonna be in judo. We know I'm gonna be in soccer. We know I'm gonna be in swimming, because those are the things that you can't change. And I'm 99% sure that I'll be doing those things, because I want to make sure that Kennedy, Reagan, CJ, and Bryson know who their dad is and know why we're doing this. And they come first and foremost, only saying that you can save all the children, but the reality is, if you're not doing what you're supposed to do at home, then you might be one of the children that you're trying to save.
That brings me to another topic. This is something I'm really, really strong about and feel strong about, and I will be knocking your door as I plan to knock on as many, you know, senators and state reps doors. Let's talk about criminal justice reform. You see, even on the federal side, they've passed the First Step Act. Is criminal justice reform, even though you're not that committee, is that something that you can sit down and see yourself being dedicated to in terms of, and this is a, you know, I've met with a number of people, a bunch of people, we have some great ideas. One of the things I want to talk about is, hey, telling the government and the state, when individuals come out of prison early, putting them in the programs for job training, and allowing some of the money that would have been used to house these individuals to go toward those training programs. Is that the type of criminal justice reform that you could possibly see yourself getting behind?
Easily get behind. I think that when we talk about voting rights, when we talk about issues like the Justice for Reinvestment Act and just being able to work with a Republican governor, two chambers, I've always been on the right side of history, just in my opinion, and I look forward to working with you on those issues. Right. That's an easy one.
Okay.
On the right side of history, huh?
Yeah.
So you about to change parties on?
Correct side of history.
Right side of, you hear that?
Yeah, ain't no convert. Ain't no convert over here.
To the office next week.
Not a chance. Now,
news right here. DMV
mind
Daily.
You, when mine was on last week, he agreed to become a Democrat. Now he's trying to drag you over.
She was sitting in the seat.
That went right over my head.
Yeah. Yo, me too. That's why I was like, what's he talking about?
Oh, no, you got to watch him.
Right side. See, only conservative right wing people can kind of understand that. You gonna get into it though. You getting into it. He knew what the hell I was talking about.
Yes, I knew it right away. I was on it.
You went Wilhelm.
I was like, I phoned a friend.
He helped me get through.
There you go.
Both you and Wilhelm were converts.
What? No, I was never a Republican. I've always been independent. I've never been a registered Republican.
To the DNC side.
No, be honest with you. You know, I'm still a Democrat from this past election. I haven't actually changed my affiliation over. And I've been hesitant to do so because I really think with this new leadership at the Maryland Democratic Party, I want to give them a chance. I think with Maya and Corey there and the people who are trying to make this reform, I would hope in my heart of hearts that they could make a change. I just has always believed that neither party truly cared about black people. And so I always remained independent because I'm like, the hell with that. Why am I going to follow an old white party boss who never gave a damn about me or my community and tell me what I should be voting for, what I should be doing? And then, you know, certain Democrats have kind of, I've followed and watched and I'm inspired by it. But I'm on but that doesn't mean I... See, this is what I don't vote party because of party. Like, I was one of the first supporters of Hogan because he, let me tell you something. He let us, he said, the hell with Fox, CBS, and all that. DMV Daily gets the first interview when they first announced they didn't have a chance in hell of winning back then. They first announced, we were the first ones to get the interview, an hour long, ask them anything they want. And they were real guys. Him and Boyd, it wasn't no political stuff. It was just real guys that wanted to make a change. And to me, that went farther than any party could ever could. And so I knew right then that That man got my vote. Didn't matter about party. And that's where I think in this country we got to get beyond. Look, you can be a registered member of a Democrat or a Republican party or the Green Party or whoever, but we got to get away from this selfishness of I'm my party. I can't. What, look what's happening in Congress. People can't go to work right now because of really because of buffoon in the White House. But for the most part, you have two parties who are really one and the same, a part of the problem sometimes, because instead of trying to compromise like they did back in the day with the McThys, and I know you're a big student of history. You read as much as I do, if not more. You know that the McMathias and all those were center Republicans and yep. center Democrats who can compromise on behalf of people. I think we've gotten away from that. This whole ideologue, the Fox News and all that, I'm going to be right wing or left wing. I don't give a damn what nobody else thinks. And then the people suffer. That's just my biggest issue.
You know what? But I would say that in the state of Maryland and on the local side, that it is a little bit different. So when I haven't talked about just the Justice for Investment Act, that was done by Republicans and Democrats. Mm-hmm. When we talked about voting rights, I know Kevin Hornberger was on the right side of it. It was several people that were Republicans that were on the right side of the issues and just issues that we work on. I enjoy working with probably Brett Wilson. He's now a judge out there in Western Maryland.
Oh, yeah, I know Judge Wilson very well.
Judge Wilson. I'm going to make sure I get it correct. But it's some of them that I really, really enjoy. I sat next to a guy, we called him Cornbread, but Delegate Anderton out on the Eastern Shore. So you kind of find...
What the hell you named before?
He on the shore, so... but the reality is that we had a good time, and we really were able to work on things. And the thing is that I appreciated folks' honesty. So when they said, look, I can probably get somewhere with you on this one, but no, I just can't. This is an issue. So that's what I respect. Right. Folks that's very honest, very upfront when it comes down to it. And then what we can work together on, we move forward.
Yeah, that's big.
So one of the red line issues for Republicans is unions. They never support anything for it. I can't remember the last time they will give, you know, felons the right to vote before they will give unions a penny of anything, of any rights, of anything. So we're so excited to have you down there. Can you talk a little bit about, I heard there's rumors of that there's going to be some kind of omnibus response to the Janus decision that's bubbling up through the legislature with Delegate Acevedo, and he's been throwing your name around.
So that is the Janus decision and all that.
So the Janus decision was basically a decision by the Supreme Court, which was basically a kill shot aimed at public sector unions, which basically said that, because normally what happens is if you're part of a union and your union has to negotiate for your pay and benefits, then you have to pay a service fee. Even if you don't want to belong, you don't have to pay the full freight. Mm-hmm. But traditionally, you had to pay some kind of fee so that there weren't free riders. So people basically that got the benefits of a contract but weren't paying for it. Mm-hmm. And so the Supreme Court basically said, in the public sector at least, that's a violation of people's First Amendment rights. Nobody has to pay anything, and each person has to sign on to become a part of the union. And so that was basically a way to kind of defund labor and their activism on the left, progressive side of the spectrum. And so what we're doing now with legislatures across the country as they come into session is figuring out ways to kind of, obviously the legislature doesn't have the power to overturn a decision of the Supreme Court, mm-hmm. but what the legislature can do is make it easier for unions to organize in different places. And one of the ways that could be possible is in the public sector in Maryland. It's set up so that each and every part of the public sector that wants to organize has to come back individually. Like, okay, I'm in the Department of, you know, Education. I want to organize. Okay, we got a bill for Department of Education. What should happen in the public sector is if I'm a public sector employee, I ought to have the right to collectively bargain, just like every single private sector employee does in the entire state of Maryland. And so I'm hearing rumors that there's going to be some kind of omnibus public sector collective bargaining bill. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
You know what? I think that we've got a tremendous amount of labor leaders coming into the General Assembly, whether it's Gabe out in Montgomery County, Melissa Wells, here in Baltimore City. And the reality is like you said, I look at the Janus bill as just like any other election that you have. So way in the 1930s, we had the right to be able to organize under the National Labor Relations Board. And they decided that once 30% said that they want to actually have a union, you can then have a vote for a union. But then once 51% decided that they will go union, that is the way, the lay of the land. But the reality is that the Supreme Court moved away from that. We can't do that in the city of Baltimore and say, you know what, that's your man, not my man. Right. We can't say that's my governor, not your governor. Once the majority decides, that is how it is. And the Supreme Court removed that opportunity for those folks. And what we called it was freeloaders. Mm-hmm. So the folks that aren't paying those union dues are still reaping those benefits, are freeloading off of the people that actually support. Okay. And what happens over the long term on a national scale, this is a way to defund folks that are truly getting out there to elect people that support their efforts and pull back those dollars that's coming out of those races. So in reference to what the legislatures are doing, I'm working with anyone that want to put forth anything to strengthen collective bargaining or strengthen the ability to be able to have to be able to unionize at your workplace. Mm-hmm. Is something that I'm not leading on the issue. I have several issues that I'll be leading on. Some of them being in reference to public safety being the biggest thing in the city of Baltimore. Absolutely. The six bills that I pre-filed, three of them is public safety. One is in reference to redistricting, ensuring that our non-police districts that we have over across the city of Baltimore, which hasn't been redistricted in the last 50 some years, making sure that we actually look at data and then saying the geographic boundaries, the service calls, how many service calls, what's the response time, and then cutting that out to say whether we had what the police districts look like. The second one is in reference to long-term efforts to deal with community policing and the short term. A lot of times when the state of Maryland is funding police issues from GOCAP, most of the time the police department are using this money for their short-term goals when it's supposed to be dealt with our long-term goals. So if we're allocating, Jason, $2 million specifically to go to issues dealing with community policing, and the legislature isn't getting a report back to say what was the money used for, mm-hmm. and was it used for what it was intended to be used for? We can't just say generically it's used for community policing, because they could say going out here get more police officers is community. No, I don't view that as community policing. The third one is in reference to the Department of Legislative Audits actually auditing our police department. It's a state agency. We should be auditing. The Liquor Board gets audited as a state agency. BCCC gets audited as a state agency. Our school system get audited as a state agency. Why is this the one agency that the states want to have a hands-off approach on when we know we need it the most? When you're talking about overtime, when you're talking about confiscating things of that nature. So those three bills passed out of the House. They couldn't make it through the Senate last year, unfortunately. You know, I was running against a senator. But we're putting them forward very early on. I pre-filed them to get them through. The other one is my friends in the Baltimore City Council just passed some legislation in reference to registering rental property. I took issue with some of the things that they done, some of the things that the agency did. And because I wasn't able to talk it through with the administration and my friends in the city council and the agency, I had to go and put in legislation. Some of the issues that I took some of the things that I took issue with is that now when you register a rental property that you can only do it online. And the reality is that I represent a population that just don't have computers. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Some folks are just not technology savvy. They might be an older population, don't want it. Some people still deal with cash. Mm-hmm. So I basically put in a bill that says that we as a city have to offer a person the in-person opportunity to pay up there. You could pay by mail or internet. You shouldn't just have one option. My worst fear is that we're doing it this time, and then next thing you know, it spring over into other things when we're trying to save money. You save a lot of money by telling everybody to go to the internet. Yeah. But the reality is that somebody has to accept that money when they're in the front door. Somebody has to open that envelope when they're doing it by mail. And I don't think that government shouldn't be that way. That's the private sector thing. If companies in the private sector want to do just internet, they have that right. But when you're talking about the public sector, we should be good to people. We're here to represent people, but also do it efficiently. But the most important part is making sure that people are represented. That's what the bill do. The second one,
well, they're doing that because they get a fee off that internet. See, when you do it internet, you do it through the mail, you don't get a fee.
Yeah, flat.
But when you do it on the internet, they can collect another fee for the convenience tax.
So I disagree with it. And I complained, nobody listened to me. And you don't want to put it in statute, but the reality is sometimes you're forced to do to go that route. In reference to the people that's inspecting the properties, they said that they were modeling it off of Baltimore County, but the reality is Baltimore County only had 5 things on their checklist. We got like 17 things on our checklist. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of things that I don't believe that a person that was a home inspector who's never been in an authoritarian position, that's always just kind of rendered like, this might be here, this might be the issue. They've never said that you pass or fail. They've never been in that position before. And Baltimore City has put them in that position. They put them in that position with a lot of things to look at, such as electrical work. I'm an electrician. The reality is the electrical inspector, another fellow electrical inspector, can tell me what to do. But you don't want somebody in the law community that ain't in the law community telling you how to argue your case. It's not fair. The other thing is they talking about pest inspections or rodent free. The reality is that we have pest inspectors. That's under statute. That's a licensed profession, and we shouldn't be diminishing their profession when we're talking about it and taking some value. So I have a bill in reference to that. And then I'll be the lead sponsor on Fight for 15 on the Senate side, which I'm very, very excited about. It's one of the things that I don't think that people should work 2 or 3 jobs in reference to being able to sustain. I think that folks should have good wages, have affordable benefits, and should be able to retire with dignity. So I'm going to love leading on this issue. But when you're talking about all these vast amount of issues, I realize the people that are successful are the ones that really entrench themselves in the subject matter. So I won't be taking on a lot. I'll probably do single digits, maybe just hit 10 or 11 bills, and then really focus on that budget and try my best to learn that budget as good as possible.
So speaking of collective bargaining.
Yes, sir.
Explain to the viewers, because I just got a wake-up call recently about this, and how can we change this or somehow, somewhere. But currently in the state of Maryland, employees like your legislative directors and state employees are under the collective bargaining. They can ride the MTA for free and all that with their badges. Whereas though people in the court system, the judicial system, mm-hmm. register of wills, courts, are not under collective bargaining, and that is because the former chief judge, Robert Bell, consistently opposed collective bargaining for the judiciary, and then his successor, Barbosa, continued to do the same thing, but they've been Barbera. Is that it? Barbera? Yeah. Yes. Thank you. has consistently done that same thing where they went up there time and time again. Mm-hmm. How do we get a level playing field even when it comes to state employees?
Yep. So I think it was Senator Nat Oaks that actually did that bill every year in reference to the MTA. And I say it because it came through my committee, Environment and Transportation. I just wanted to correct you on one thing. So like my staff don't get to ride the bus for free, but there are folks in the executive office.
I used to do it when I was working for
the bus driver. Probably didn't look to say, but it, like I worked on the bill, or actually went through. It's certain ones in DLS and it's certain ones in the executive committee that do have the opportunity to ride the bus for free. Mm-hmm. And I think that Nat's bill might have been like everybody ride, or maybe he might have been taking the privileges away. I can't remember, but I think it was everybody riding. But he was dealing with that issue because he didn't think that it was right for it. But I think that everything costs. When you're dealing with a bill, the most important thing that you look at is the fiscal note. What's the fiscal responsibility that's going to come? Who's going to actually be paying for it? So when you're talking about riding the bus for free, the reality is it's still taxpayers that's paying for the issue. But that was
just a part of the collective bargaining entire agreement. In other words, the courts aren't under any collective bargaining agreement.
Okay, so they negotiated that. That's how I'm about to say the employees, that the media staff, that, and you would notice under Salim Marriott, you weren't under a collective bargaining agreement. So you're like a free agent out there where the folks in DLS or some of them in the legislative committees probably are. And those are the ones that probably could or couldn't ride. And I'm sure that whenever you're collective bargaining, you're giving up and you are negotiating. So I don't know what they gave up. I don't know what was there to be able to ride the bus for free. I don't know that type of history. I just know that Senator Oaks was one of the people to try to deal with the issue. I would would go on to say that anything can be legislated, that anyone can be able to put in a bill. You just need a bill sponsor. And I, like I said, I know that Senator Oaks worked on that issue.
Well, I need a bill sponsor. Yep. It's not for that, though. Yep. It's for my bill. That everybody knows what it is.
What's your bill?
I passed it in the city council, and 85% of the voters approved it.
Okay.
And it lowered the age from 21 to 18 to run for city council.
Okay.
Because if you're 18, you got a right to go and die for your country. Mm-hmm. You got a right to go out there and drive a car and everything else. And you can register to vote, but you can't run for office is a tragedy. Mm. So I had a bill that Joan Carter Conway simply put in a drawer.
I remember this
and told me that Mike Miller didn't want it. Yeah. Told me the bill hearing was next week when it was actually sponsor? The next day. Joan Carter Conway. That's the crazy part about it. And the bill got killed nonetheless. But it would lower the age from 21 to 25 for delegate and senator to 18 to be able to run. It just makes common sense. We already passed it in Baltimore City for city council. Mm-hmm. We need this done on a state level. And the governor has already said, and I got him on video, so he better not even think about changing up. Said that he would approve it if it
is. It goes through Ehe, right?
And
which
we don't got nobody
from Baltimore. Why did he say that? Not from the city, from the conference.
That was set up.
Going to be able to.
You need to go find your girl. She'd be like, hey.
That you done threw off the city delegation. Yeah. You may want to invite her back on.
I'm just saying.
I mean,
it may be an opportunity there.
Yeah.
No, I was going to ask a question, though. Senator, I wanted to ask a question because just in today's Baltimore Sun, there was a conversation about untraceable guns and the legislators probably moving forward in Annapolis. Mm-hmm. What's your position on untraceable guns, 3D printing guns, and what any type of legislation are you looking at as far as any gun regulation or gun reform coming up in this session?
Yep. So I'm not going to be leading on that issue. So I just wanted to be clear for the folks that's watching and the folks that's actually listening. But I will support something like that. It's very common sense. The guns now, they've got technology where you can print a gun from this
with the 3D printers.
Printing. And yeah. It's been in the courts, I believe. I think the attorney general's been dealing with the issue. So this is an issue that we're going to have to deal with in the legislation. When you talk about our airports, when you talk about our schools, there's so many vast issues. But that's a common sense one that I will be on. What did you say? The correct side of history?
There you go. That's right. Never the right side.
I wouldn't be able to catch it. But it was 3D guns and something else. That I know what you're talking about. It was 3D guns and something else.
And probably the bump stocks. And
we did that. The bump stocks, we did that last. Yeah. We did that the last session. But this 3D guns is something new that I want to say came up on us in the last 6 months, and I think
it was also purchasing parts, so you can purchase parts that separately that don't have any serial markings in it, and then build a gun from out of parts.
So I don't know which one of my colleagues are already, and that's one of the things too, is sometimes when colleagues are already working on an issue, you have to be respectful of that. Mm-hmm. Because you may have we got a large delegation that's coming into the Senate, you have a decent amount that's coming in the House. One of the things is just like the streets, don't go all up in everybody else's territory without letting them know. And working with them instead of, because you might find
since
yourself
in the awkward situation. They just stole Frank Conway's bill every damn chance they got.
Oh, Lord, now we're back to Frank Conway.
I think they did. Because he put in that bill for cameras on uniforms of police way before it was a national thing. They laughed his ass out of the House, said, man, you must be crazy.
He's speaking truth.
And then the leadership came back after it became a national phenomenon, and Delegate Sandy Rosenberg. And Lisa Gladden might have still been there. That's usually his partner in crime when they introduce bills together. They took the credit for the bill when it got passed, but that was Frank's bill for years, and they ended up. So let's not act like it's kumbaya up there. You know niggas be stealing people's bills.
No, I think that one of the things is that, like,
now you cut it out, man.
You have to be mindful of who you do. Like, very much so, respectfully. Right. So some people might have it happen to them, but you ain't doing that to everybody.
But you ain't cutting nobody's throat introducing my bill, though. I just want you to know.
Right. There's a clear path. Yeah, make sure
put that up in there.
Shirley is not standing in your way, Corey. If you want that bill, you can have it. You hear me?
But I think it's called ghost guns.
Ghost guns, yep.
Right,
yep.
That's one terminology. Yep. And in the House, Majority Leader, Delegate Kathleen.
Okay. She's leading. They take up those issues. So one of the things is that you'll find that is four respective committees in the Senate, six respective committees in the House, and people do try to tackle the issues that's in front of that committee because you have a vote on that committee, and it's a very higher percentage chance that your colleagues are more inclined to work with you because you're voting on a bunch of stuff that comes through that committee. So Kathleen Dumais at one point in time was the vice chair of judiciary. She's always worked on, Vanessa Atterbury is, but like she's always worked on those issues.
What about anything as far as public safety is concerned?
I went through those three bills that are very, very important. So like when people say public safety, like they always think about just locking people up. Everything ain't about locking people up.
Well, I'm talking about funding safe streets, more funding for safe streets, more funding for.
So I'm a dig into one. I just wrote an op-ed in reference to what do you real public safety. Like when folks think of it, they always think about the criminal aspect of it, but you want to know how you really get safe streets is put these young people to work. So we had 8,000 people that went to work this past summer that were between the ages of 16 to 21, but it was 2,000 that filled out their application on time. So you know how many applications I get for scholarships that don't come on time, but they filled it out on time, went through the entire process and still wasn't able to go to work for minimum wage is what we're talking. We're only talking a couple million dollars to put these folks to work. Right. That's what I call safe streets. That's what I talk about with crime prevention. And those are the issues that I'm going to work fiercely on is because I know that if that person is working in a law firm or doing something like that, he ain't on these streets. And when you got that idle time, you know what you could be doing versus where you're at. Then they're actually making a wage. And they might be around somebody productive while they're doing it. So it's so many reasons why to be able to be proactive instead of always reactive. That's my largest frustration. Is a lot of the policy ideas that we come up with is always reactionary instead of just getting in front of the issue.
Well, and speaking of reactionary public safety, we're talking about 300 homicides for 4 years straight now.
Yes, sir.
But guess what's killing people more than us? Fentanyl and heroin. And we've had over double of the number of homicides and the number of overdeaths. How do we, do y'all have a plan on attacking? Yeah, I know the governor has the lieutenant governor running around the state. But the problem is, number one, they're taking most of the resources that used to be dedicated to Baltimore City and Prince George's, especially Baltimore because it was the heroin capital of the world and it still is. And they're putting them into white communities.
Anne Arundel counties,
the Calvert counties, who still, they do have overdose deaths. Baltimore City is high, but guess who's right after us? Calvert County, Anne Arundel County.
Harford County.
Western Maryland don't even have the facilities to be able to deal with the issues. So a lot, they've really taken a big bleeding up there because they're actually coming down. And you don't have that time luxury to be able to sacrifice that when you're talking about dealing with the issues. But one of the things.
How do you deal with that?
So the reality is that I have to be respectful of Senator Hayes because we already done things to deal with it also. Okay. So he actually got passed the HOPE Act, I want to say in the 2017-2018 legislative session, which was a huge bill with a huge fiscal note that actually got done. And working with the governor, working with the Senate's side, but it took him 3 years to actually deal with that. So mental health, substance abuse is some of the things that he's done. And because he sat on HGO was a very, very pivotal point. In reference to that, one of the things that I really, really try my best to do well, when you talk about time and when you talk about doing, I try to stay in my lane and figure out things that I'm good at and really dig down and work hard on that. And I support other people that take on certain subject matters. So if I had to give any advice to any candidate or anybody that's running for office, pick three things that you really want to tackle that 4 year period and really hammer at those things. And don't try to conquer the world because the reality is people are going to remember you if you took on those big issues and actually cut into it and make a dent. So one of the people that I was salute is Antonio Hayes because we've already looked at the HOPE Act within, I can't remember, I think it was this past session, and he's also the chair of the opioid
joint. That's a passionate
Hayes. So just first shout out to the work that he's done, but support the brother on the work that he's doing, and I hope that the mental health community come together around him, lift him up, embrace him, and keep pushing him forward. So I do know that he has an agenda. We haven't talked specifically what are the agenda items, but I think that he'll leverage his position to kind of tackle that issue a little bit more.
And that bill was actually in 2017.
Okay, good. And see, you got that computer right there. I don't got that luxury. But that was like a three or four big bills wrapped up into one to deal with the issue. So I want to say shout out to my colleague and my big brother, Antonio Hayes, but it was the lieutenant governor. It was Eric Brownwell was the governor that was really, really working on trying to figure out how do you get this through, knowing that we got a Republican governor and a Democratic legislature.
So let's bring it down to Baltimore, a couple of Baltimore issues. And I know not all of these things are going to come to Annapolis, but
the radio usually ain't this fun.
But I happen to know that you take a passing interest in Baltimore things that may not necessarily be in Annapolis. Uh-huh. Just a passing interest. Yeah, passing. Because yep. I know everyone tries to make you, you know, the kingmaker. You have some kind of empire, and that's not fair to you. You're just
I don't even have my right. hands.
He don't even have nothing to do with it. Have nothing to do with it. So get off him, Jack. So what? So. Here's the question. Here's my question. And this is yes or no. This is actually. Oh no! I'm sorry. I take it back. Anyway, so
all right, pop your side your head.
I didn't even say who it was. I just said Jack. Actually, Jack. Anybody? Now you done gave it away.
You know who you talking about.
Tell us about. The Hopkins Police Force.
The Hopkins Police Force.
Where are you at on it? You're going to have a vote. People are going to want to know, are you a no? Are you a yes? Are you a, I'll cut a deal? I'll cut. People want to know where you are. I feel like Mary and Joan have been. Joan? God, not Joan. Jesus, no. Mary and Jill have been very kind of forthright, like, we're a no. It don't matter. We're not interested. No. Whereas I think you and Antonio have been kind of laying back in the cut a little bit, saying like, well, what you got? You know what I mean? And so talk to us about, are you a no, a firm no? And if you're not a firm no, you know, what are you looking for to get to?
Yes? I think that one of the things is that one of the things we framed ourselves in the House of Delegates was a leader that listens. I think it's very important. We do a whole lot of talking as legislators and we don't listen enough. So you saw me at the Hopkins Forum that was down there at the Hepcat Bill, 901 East Milton Street. You saw me at the Senate Delegation Forum because people actually want to be heard. And I got constituents that are mixed on the issue. Mm-hmm. So you have some that are far this way. You have some that feel this way. But the reality is that the bill hasn't even been introduced at this moment to see like, hey, what does it come in a different context of what it looked like than this past year? And like, who's going to be did they actually listen to the community when they do come into that context? And what does that look like? So one of the things that I've learned in the legislature is I really don't shut issues down immediately. Okay. Shut them. Like, that's just not who I am.
Okay.
So I do hear folks out, and I think we got enough time to still hear it out.
But see, this is the Pandora's box that I want y'all to think about before you open that door, right? Because I actually have been somewhat supportive of the Hopkins. I know people have. If I was legislator, I would be like you. I wouldn't vote one way or the other. But to me, it kind of makes sense, but it also doesn't in some sense.
We don't have a vote, right? It's not there. Need to take the position right now because you're not pushing a button and you let folks know immediately once you figure out where you at, right. Just let them know where you at.
But here's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you read earlier today, and I'm not going to mention their racist publication, but nonetheless, there was a group now that's downtown Baltimore Partnerships now has introduced the idea of having their own police force like Hopkins.
I've expressed that concern. Yep. The reality is that there are 27 police forces out there, but they're all state and local police forces. So when you're talking about the MTA, the Baltimore City Police Force, like we have a good pulse and can push down different things that we our opinion on. But when you're talking about the private sector, so it's not just downtown Baltimore. What if Michael want one tomorrow? What if Loyola want one tomorrow? What if the Institute of Notre Dame want one tomorrow? Like, it's so many people that can kind of say, so you're now setting a precedent, and what does that precedent look like? That's one of the issues that I've expressed to them, and it's one of the concerns that, like, how do we know that this isn't the one? Like, I've really dug down into this issue and was actually looking at it a little bit today because what we have the luxury as a legislator is to say we have a staff with DLS. You work in the legislature. So we have DLS, the libraries, that can research different parts of it. So it was things that happened in 1974 that I'll bring up and show my hand like, oh, okay, so we had this right here was established. Do this need to be established for this? Police, you know, so just raising those questions. But right now is the moment that you prepare because you're not in the game. You're about to be in the game, and I want to be ready for the game when it comes.
Speaking of, you wrote an article. You said, where'd you post the article at?
So I'm a very, very big fan of the Afro.
Okay.
One of the
not a fan of DMVDaily.news. Oh, no. Got that plug in there.
DMV Daily. That's why I'm here.
Okay.
Y'all look.
We gotta get you posting these.
Would you rather have him here for an hour and a half or sending us some op-ed?
I'd rather have both.
We want both.
Right.
Why I wasn't on the show yet is what I was wondering. I was getting up a hard time. I said, man, I've been on this show for a while now, and I ain't got my invite yet.
You gotta blame my editor in chief for that one.
Yeah, I'm gonna put that on him. You never said
I've been harassing on folks. No, but the reality is that I've always been a fan of all three, all four gentlemen. So when you say, hey, Corey, can you get over here? What do? As soon as I can figure out how to make time, I make time. Same thing. If Ivan want to break bread, what do? Figure out how to make time. And Hassan already know we've been on the phone 12-1, some very late points in time, talking about contentious issues, the city of Baltimore, state of Maryland. And the only reason why I respect it is because you all are actually doing the work. So you got folks that talk about the work, but then you got folks that's actually in the street that is doing the work, and that's what I respect. And that's why I always come forward, and I spend my 5, 6 o'clock right now with y'all.
Don't get scared though when the session starts and we up there with the microphone.
Yeah, we're coming up. We coming to Annapolis. We bringing all this equipment up there.
He gonna have to run to a deputy recording secretary caucus meeting. So I know he. Here's another quick question.
Chasing you down that tunnel.
I know Clyde would want
you
me to ask him.
You know it. I ain't giving that up. It gets me everywhere.
I know Clyde would want me to ask. Guns. Armed officers in the schools.
Yep. So one of the things is that I think the bill was brought about 3-4 years ago. Mm-hmm. I thought that it was introduced the wrong way. I didn't think that they had a conversation with my community. I think that they had went in there already knowing that they had enough votes. Mm-hmm. It really didn't even entertain us because I found out about it through Twitter. So somebody was like Twitter handling me and I was like, oh, okay, all right. So at that moment, I knew I was a hard no because I think that if they weren't respecting the legislators that actually have to vote for it, I knew they wasn't respecting the community. I'm not sure why they didn't introduce it the last 3 or 4 years after. I think it might have happened 2015, my first year in there, and it hasn't been seen since. No. I think that when I looked at the pre-file bills, my colleague actually in my district, Delia Cheryl Glenn, is the sponsor of, so the bill's already been pre-filed, already in there. So she has the bill year. And I know that we'll be tackling the issue. But one of the things is that I did go to one of the public hearings that was at the school headquarters. I want to say this might have been 2-3 months ago.
Yeah, I remember.
Yep. And I'll be open to see wherever they have some more public hearings. But like folks are, you got some folks that are very passionate. Like, look, and when I came up, it was guns in schools. So like when I was going through school, I didn't know that you know, like I didn't
was really an issue.
Yeah, I didn't really see it as it, but it looked like they had been doing it for illegally. And I think that Dr. Thornton at that time wanted to address the issue, or someone, one of the school CEOs wanted to address the issue. They just didn't do it the right way. So how I know the way to get a hard no is not engaging my community. I do know that part, and that's with any bill. So that could be you come with a bill.
So you're not a hard no.
I'm not a hard no. Okay. No, not at all.
Yeah, because the union supports it, and even we spoke to Barksdale about it, and he definitely supports. Well,
Clyde has always been, but
Boatwright, you mean?
Yeah, Boatwright.
I'm sorry, Boatwright. I'm sorry.
Boatwright has always been there, but like I said, I'm here representing over 100,000 folks, and my job is to ensure that their voices are heard, that I have a good pulse of the community, and that I hear them out before making any decision.
And shout out to Tony Barksdale, friend of the program, a good personal friend of mine, who the mayor should. It's been said earlier that it's been done, but it's still, I guess, ongoing. He could be the next criminal director.
Well, I will say one thing about that, though. And he was on the show, full disclosure. We interviewed him. I was very impressed with him.
Too. How many people been on this show?
I don't remember anybody before you, Corey. But anyway. What I will say is we had Barksdale on. He seemed very knowledgeable. But then, like, I'm reading some of the tweets that he has, and he has a very conservative idea about law enforcement. He thought the idea of a consent decree was ridiculous. He tweeted that we should just let the police be the police. And, you know, like all kinds of stuff that I don't, there are a lot of folks that are very supportive of him in community and in this role that I don't know if they really realize where he's coming from or what his perspective is, because I know that that's not something that normally most of us are like down with, but like, let's unleash the police.
And the young lady that joined us for the Anad Saeed from the Rolling Stones reporter.
Yeah.
Amelia.
Yeah.
She and I went back and forth on this on Twitter earlier today because she raised those same points. Anthony Barksdale, Tony, says some things on Twitter that is to entice debate. Doesn't necessarily mean he always wholeheartedly believes in those things. And if you know Tony, like Brandon Scott does, and I know you know Tony, that is not the way he operates and thinks. Now, he does bring up a great point when it comes to the consent decree. It was the worst goddamn thing to happen to Baltimore City because you can, first of all, that did not reform a goddamn thing for real. Second of all, you could have reformed officers without the consent decree. And all that did was handcuff officers from either doing what they think was their job or made them say, you know what, I'm not going to do my job now because of this consent decree. And as an officer, you got to understand he has a different mindset than other people. But this is still the youngest deputy police commissioner whose crime plan, again, led to the lowest amount of homicides, violent crime, and a reduction in the past 30-some years in Baltimore City. So, I mean, he's not perfect, and I'm not going to defend him on, like, he agreed with the officer who beat the boy on North Avenue because he said the guy touched his walkie-talkie. So he deserved it. No, he don't deserve no shit like that. You turn him around, you handcuff him.
Right.
Mace him if you got to. But you don't got to pull your gun out, and you damn sure don't got to put your hands on the boy the way he did. That was personal. You could tell that was personal.
North Avenue or-
and
no,
he
that
also
was the one up on, in West Baltimore when you saw the boy like beating him over. He was beating him
at the bus stop.
No, that one, the bus stop was Green Mountain.
Yeah, that's my kid.
No, you're talking about the one on East,
over at North.
The city on now, we got
on West Baltimore, North Avenue. When it was just a recent one, a couple of earlier this year, and you saw it was personal. That this officer
Orleans Street. And wasn't when Orleans Street. Officer, yeah, like, the new was, like, officer trying to stop it, and then he got fired.
Yeah,
like
the new officer. He resigned.
Monument, you're right.
Monument Street.
He got fired and charged with assault. Yeah, how do you justify beating him down like...
Right, talking about when he touches... Now, again, you're not going to agree with that. I damn sure don't agree with nothing like that. But you're not going to agree. That's my thing. You're never going to. I'm not going to agree with this knucklehead on everything. And if we do, there's a problem because somebody's lying.
Well, it's not about agreeing on every. But when you portray a certain mindset, I don't want you in charge of criminal justice policy in this city. Well,
no,
I don't.
Let me tell you something. Tony comes from these streets. Okay. Nobody is more qualified to be in that position
We're not talking about qualifications. We're talking about philosophy. Well, right. What is your philosophy on policing? And there's no question that he's qualified.
It's community policing. He's the one who implemented the Sheila Dixon, Fred Bielfeld community
policing. And I don't think his statement was 100% correct as far as the consent decree and even your statement on the consent decree. Because there's a lot of folks that really felt that they took a knee way before the consent decree.
But they did it when they made the consent decree.
Well, the consent decree has some, and even from looking at it from a legal point of view, it has some major issues and flaws. On one hand, things that the Supreme Court tells officers they should be able to do, the consent decree says you can't do that. Mm-hmm. So if you're an officer, you're saying, well, wait, you taught me in school as being an officer to follow the law, but I can't do this. And one of the reasons is for policing. One of the issues in the consent decree, they don't want you to clear the corners. And officers are like, you need to clear the corners because they're standing there. And so someone gets mad, they shoot up the whole corner. Because, you know, so there are some issues with the consent decree, but there are some really great things with the consent decree as well. You know, I don't know if the consent decree is something that's fluid that says, you know what, Your Honor, you know, Judge Bedard, this is a piece that we're finding out is not working, so can we get rid of this piece? I don't know. However, I think that, you know, now that, you know, Tony hopefully will get the position, that's something that he'll have to decide. He'll have to figure out and sit and speak with Ken Thompson and, you know, the other people in the community to find out what's working. But I can tell you this. This is what I know about the streets. If they don't respect you, they will run over you every single day.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Barksdale's name gives you street credibility. There ain't nobody in the city right now in the criminal justice system with a name that's giving them respect, because them streets, them boys don't care.
And I think that's why Mayor Pugh is considering him, because you know he's been a critic of this administration.
He was Sheila Dixon's driver.
He wasn't her driver.
Howard was her driver. Well, every time I saw her during the campaign, he was driving her around.
Cut it out, man.
He did drive her around.
Yeah, he supports Mayor Sheila Dixon. Okay, okay. She's the one who made him deputy police commissioner. Right. He made her plan, so he's going to support her. But, there you go. You can't. This is the problem with the administration, and this is what I can't stand about. Because you support you and you have a relationship with an opponent, then you're going to take that out on somebody and not hire the most qualified, best person because they supported your opponent?
Nobody
absolutely ridiculous. No, it did happen. So don't act like it didn't. Because it did. And it happens over and over. It happened. Stephanie Rawlins Blake got in. Yes. She got rid of everything that was Sheila Dixon related.
Right. Well,
absolutely ridiculous. Elections have
consequences, okay? Yeah. I'm not going to have my closest advisor. I'm not going to have my closest. Well, a job like that, the director of the mayor's office of criminal justice is a very close advisor.
Yeah, so but if it's working, I don't give a goddamn who you.
Well, that's you, but you're not the elected. The point I'm making is that if I'm an elected official, my closest advisors are going to tend to be people that got on the bus with me when we started on this journey.
Okay, rather but then than they people, fire everybody, and if you were involved with that.
No, I didn't suggest that.
And it's not just the Sheila Dixon thing. This happens in administrations across the
board. Yes, normally when a new team comes in, did you keep Mac McFadden's legislative director? Did you keep his chief of staff? Did you keep his chief of staff? Are they still there? Oh, okay. And there you have it.
That's two or three people. That's the same. Oh,
let me ask. Order in the court. A question. Now, you were able to defeat an incumbent that had been there for many years. Here's a question I have for you. There's no bill or anything like that, but how do you feel about term limits?
I think that the reality is that some folks will make you think like, hey, because it's hard to beat an incumbent. That's the reality. It's hard to take down an incumbent. I do think that elections are term limits, but you know, I guess I'm open, but like I think that elections ultimately are the term limits.
Absolutely.
Yes, I agree.
You can't beat them, then you be either join them or go on the sideline and complain. All that shit about that.
Or join their staff.
Because what happens too is like
you need people with seniority that knows how to make things happen. But like
one of the points too is that you also lose some of the history in reference to what happened.
Seniority in some cases.
Yeah, when you're talking about some of these issues, when you're talking about like Medicaid, when you're talking about things that have been going on for long periods of time, there is some value. So that's just almost like losing somebody in DLS. Sometimes there is some value. So you can't have everybody leaving at once, you know, like a 50, 60% turnout. Majority of the folks are leaving because it takes you about 2 years just to get the wheel spinning. You know what I mean? To figure out like where's everything going or some of the things. So it's kind of got to be that bridge in that gap to where you have a decent amount of folks that return versus a new crop. But that wasn't what was happening in the Baltimore. Like everybody was just staying. Like it was no return that was happening. And that places us in challenge because you don't get the new ideas that you need.
Speaking of, we were just talking about law enforcement. What's your position as far as LIBOR is concerned? Are there anything you're looking at addressing this legislative session?
That was one of the things that I was actually looking at today. And when I looked at LEOBR, I think that we all agree in reference to the time frame when a police officer has been questioned in reference to questionable issues. So it's five days right now. I think that it was trying to be negotiated whether it was 3 days, 72 hours.
I thought it was 10 days originally. Did they get it down to five?
No, it's 5 days.
Okay.
And then it was another issue that I disagreed
citizen
with.
Involvement as far as the
trial board was an easy one. It was another issue in reference to the time frame that I can't immediately
then they always have their attorney. You know, it's interesting because say for instance, God forbid, you know, my brother, I don't have a brother, but say I had a brother and they got arrested, then he doesn't have the opportunity to have his representative, but the police officer does, and they have the 5 day time period to sit down with their attorney to give their statement. And, you know, and all of that. But the unique issue,
story.
Well, the unique thing now is that body camera footage. So body camera has really changed the game in a lot of ways. So they give their story, and but they could jack themselves up more. But I'm sorry, I don't want
to steal. I think there's two issues, that being one of them, in reference to the time frame, in reference to when they actually get questioned, is I think that's a lengthy amount of time. And it's another one. So it's two issues that if I had the opportunity, that I would be supportive of addressing.
And this administration, to their credit, just negotiated a contract.
The other one wasn't trial boards, though. It was another one dealing with time frame.
That allowed, that the police agreed to have the citizens on that trial board. So that will be coming in the near future. Right. So.
Well, I know Ivan also mentioned the body cams, and I think that's something that needs to be looked at legislatively as well. Making sure that it's mandated, because you have officers now that in some cases turn the camera off at will.
But they're already mandated. Yeah, that was a part of the legislation.
Yeah. Well, some of them now, when they do, they get in trouble. Yeah. You know, because if you sit down and look at one of the officers who went to trial and they talked about a reenactment, he said, because I would get in trouble for not having my body camera on. I mean, for the most part now the issues, and I'm saying this because, you know, I'm seeing more and more body camera footage as a defense attorney. Now the problem is you're looking for a specific angle, but you just don't get it because the body camera just doesn't cover it. You know,
so well, that's the trickery in some cases. They're I don't know if you've ever seen these YouTube videos, but some of these YouTube videos show that on purposely, in some cases, officers hold their guns in a certain position.
So I think that blocks, the legislation deal them. With folks that know what, if their intent, like if they didn't do it on purpose, then they're covered. But like if they, the intent
you can see
was,
it's been deceived. Yeah,
I think that deceit. Like, so when I talk about subject matter experts, I know that Frank Conway's historically worked on this issue. Sid Noor has all worked on this issue. So you do have folks that work on an issue in reference to like what gets showed.
Right.
So when you're dealing with children, I don't know if we've solved or addressed all of those issues. Sensitive information. Right.
Privacy.
Privacy issues, I don't think, has been tackled fully. And I've seen bills that haven't gotten passed, but I know that we'll see stuff on that.
Speaking of which, let me ask you something. How do we deal with, and I know this is a big point that you've addressed before, being a business owner yourself. Mm-hmm. And I know something Senator Robinson, she had dealt with for years too. Minority inclusion and a lot, like even the body cameras. Somebody has to deal with these cameras with the state. Somebody sells it to them. There's profit in all of this stuff, right? Nope, how do we get more minority inclusion in on across the board on a lot of this stuff? That's
red light cameras, speed cameras.
We have to be intentional in reference to it. So when we get those opportunities, Hassan, as legislators, I'm going to bring back up the example that I talked to my friends and my colleagues about, go back to this rental bill. So they created a new industry when they could have cut it out and said, we're going to give preference to businesses that are in the city, or we're going to give preference to minority business owners that are home inspectors. You know, so like you can put that in the legislation and do it where it's not breaking anybody's constitutional responsibilities, but we don't. So they've created a $1 million industry that we're not thoughtful. We have these industries that come before our bodies, and we have to be intentional, because there are of ethnicities that's very intentional, of a bodies that's intentional, and we have to be equally, if not more, is intentional when we see those opportunities. So as a young leader in the city of Baltimore, even though I'm not on the city council, immediately when I saw it, I brought it up to my friends and said, we missed the shot.
Here's a question I want to ask you. And I know I didn't read the article, but I know they were talking about something in terms of bail and what has the legislation done. For the most part, thanks to the law that's passed and the Court of Appeals decision, kind of killed the bail industry when you sit down and look at it. But on one hand, it's been positive, but on another hand, it's been negative. I think you have 36% more people held in Baltimore City without bail than ever before, than before the law. When you look at that particular issue in terms of bail, do you feel that's something we need to fine tune? Are you happy with where it is? Or do you feel like, hey, I want to go back to where it was before and looking
so
at
it? So for the folks that's listening, the folks that's watching, I think the 2 years ago is what
about 2 years Ivan ago, the Court of Appeals
referencing, and there was a bill to actually do something about the Court of Appeals decision, or to kind of let it play out and see what actually happens. So what Ivan is representing, and now there's actually report and data that shows the effects of the Court of Appeals decision, and we'll have to say whether that was did harm, whether it did good, or how does it look in that situation. I know that people have emailed me a couple of the reports. I think that maybe Abel or somebody else did a report, but at that time 2 years ago, I was on the side where you say let it just flow out, let it just see what happened, and we were being lobbied very, very hard, very intense campaign to kind of change the industry by some black folks too, and I was on the side that just said let's get the data to see whether that was the correct way to go about it.
Well, looking at it now, are you for increased funding for pretrial, would you say?
Increased funding and pretrial. I think that I would be for increased funding for pretrial. And but you also have to find the money too, Ivan. So when we talk about those things, we have to see what does it look like when we're talking about with legislation, and how do we pay for that as taxpayers, and is that the right way? And sometimes you kind of walk your way into it. So maybe it's done over a period of time instead of doing it. And I don't think that people should be locked up for bail for body, or get body attachments for credit card bills, or somebody that's trying to you didn't pay this bill and he was able to go through the courts, and next thing you know you're losing your license, or you're locked up, you lost your job, for those types of things. So I think that we do need criminal justice reform in reference to how we deal with the issues, in reference to how folks go about getting locked up, and how what we pursue, what defines what you get locked up for.
So, Corey, under your old adage of the way to get Corey to be a hard no is not to consult his community, what do you think about this new police commissioner nomination, the degree to which the community has been consulted or not?
Yep. So examples of hard no's will be the school police when it was first introduced, just so people clear in reference to how you get a hard no from Corey, or when the Hopkins bill was first introduced. I knew where I was at on the issue because of the short amount of time that they were telling us to deal with the issue, and I didn't have a pulse in my community. So how you get a hard no from Corey is not talking to him. And I think that folks have been able to adjust and like respond, like, oh, okay, now I know how to deal with Corey now. Right. Like, don't talk to him.
Right.
You know, because at the end of the day, what Drake said, give me my respect. You know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day, it's respect, because if they don't respect you, they're not respecting your community. So then you talked about the police commissioner.
And I gave you 2 weeks, damn it, to introduce my bill. The same time I was talking
to God damn. I walked in and I talked about like nine, might not get the double digits. Right. Like, I really want to learn a budget. He like, look, I got some more for your plate. Here we go.
You better call Shirley. You better call her.
But Mark asked the question in reference to the police commissioner. I think that when you talk about the transparency in reference to the police commissioner, I think many people, majority, would agree that it has been a very transparent process. And there has been great amount of challenges that faced around this process. I just hope that my city council colleagues will do their due diligence, because Durrell was a lot of our friends, but the reality is that we didn't check them the way we were supposed to. And I think that they're learning from that incident, and they're going to be thoroughly. I can see it's just a lot different how we're going about handling it from a city council standpoint, not administration, but the city council standpoint, is that they're also liable and have a responsibility in reference to the
community. I don't think Dr. Batts did anything for us either. I mean,
I can vaguely remember his, because his happened under the Rawlins Blake administration, if I can remember. I think I was just coming in.
He had such a huge learning curve. I mean, he even compared Baltimore to the 1950s civil rights struggles.
Well, the racial. He was right on point with that.
Oh, with the riot that happened.
Before that, he was saying that Baltimore had this culture.
It's a racial city.
Right. That was
what I say. In the criminal justice system, if you ain't been from Baltimore, you haven't been in the system.
Yeah, it's different.
That's the same thing with Chris Gerald. I hate to be like that.
No, don't tell him. Look.
I know the criminal justice system. I go all around the state and all around the country. Things that fly in Baltimore County, Montgomery County, Harford County, they don't fly in Baltimore.
In Texas.
And vice versa.
Oh my God.
Look at how we congregate. Like, I don't move too much out of East Baltimore. So, like, folks, they don't come over here too much. Like, it's just, it's kind of sad.
I got cousins who have never been to the East Side.
Exactly. Oh, well, you say, like, a small street, you'd be like, where Port Street at? I'd be like, oh, you just go right around the corner, boom, boom, boom.
Right.
And you say something over in West Point, I'd be like, I don't know.
It's the whole. That's why I say my problem is, and you know, you can say what you want to say about Fitzgerald. My problem is, I don't know who's going to be his right hand, mm-hmm. but whoever his right hand is going to be needs to understand Baltimore City and policing in Baltimore City.
Well, so here's the problem with the setup, and I've said this before. I called for a very transparent process, and they need to be, you know, have. And I got a call from the council, and they said, "Oh, well, we never before. We are going to have a forum, an all-day forum on a Saturday, so the people can come down and, you know, express themselves." And I said, "Well, that's a great release valve, you know." And then now I find out today that, oh, Fitzgerald's not coming to that. This is just the public going to speak to the council. And my question is, if I want to speak to my council member, I can email him. You know, like,
who's going to come down on a Saturday right, at City Hall?
To talk to the city council. That's exactly the problem. And, I mean, I understand the impetus behind it, but it really is disheartening that folks are not going to get the chance to have an opportunity. I guess they're supposed to be.
But I bet you he'll be up at the Jewish Community Center Sunday.
Oh, yeah. By invite only.
You're damn right.
No, with ID.
It's not by invite only.
Yes,
it's
is. That. Invite with ID. It says so online.
Well, you just really have to have ID. Because trust and believe, ain't everybody getting up in there.
Of course.
I can tell you, Dwayne Shorty Davis, my man, they ain't getting up in there.
Well, there's Calvin one in Lewis, there's
they,
one
they
in Park Heights.
Screen people.
Here's my concern, and I want to say this on the show because I'm going to be saying it on Facebook. There are people that think that if they don't make it to Park Heights or if they don't make it to Morgan, they'll just go on Saturday to City Hall. He's not going to be there at City Hall. So if you got something you want to say to the commissioner you better get up to Park Heights or you better go up to Morgan
RSVP.
All right. Well, it's that time. Well, we start on time and we end on time here on the DMV Daily Radio Show. Senator-elect Cory McCray.
Yes, sir.
First Vice Chairman Cory McCray.
You got to come back because we didn't even do Baltimore City elections with you yet. He filibustered me through it. I didn't get to it.
And that's what we're going to be talking about all next week and into the new year.
Yes, sir.
2020 in Baltimore City.
Am I the first senator on here?
You are.
Yeah, the first senator.
There you go. See? Matter of fact, I don't think any delegates have been on here either. I think you're the first.
Yeah.
Then your Republican friend called in from Western Maryland to announce his congressional run. He's a delegate. He's a delegate? What?
From Baltimore, man.
Oh, from Baltimore.
And he just called in for 2 seconds because he was making a big announcement.
That I completely screwed up.
Yes, you did. But anyway, we'll be back tomorrow. Tomorrow's Friday. Have a happy new year if we don't see you before then. If you don't come and tune in tomorrow. And remember, new promise begins with a new day. Therefore, the promise of tomorrow is greater than that of yesterday.
Free Keith Davis.
Free Keith Davis.